Hello everyone. I'd like to welcome everyone to today. Just want to make sure if everybody can hear me okay. I heard a little fuzz going on there. Just want to make sure there's no issue. If you can, one or two, just type in yes, you can hear me. Be perfect. Perfect, perfect. Thank you. Like I said, just heard a little scratchy sound. Just want to make sure we were all good. All right. So this month's Tech Talk is Stand Out with Reality Modeling in Your Site Design. What we're going to be talking about is this new way of working, which is called reality modeling. And what it's going to do is going to help you be able to deliver better results to your clients faster, which is what we always want to be able to do. We want to make sure they're happy. And we're going to walk through that today, sort of why, how, where we've been able to do that. So let's just go into the agenda real quick, just to give you an idea, because it's going to be a fast 30 minutes. We're going to talk about what is the difference between reality model and reality modeling. They are two different things. Then we're going to look at how does it fit into a workflow. We're going to go through and we're going to play with the software a little bit. We're going to show you some of that. Talk about a case study. We're using this multiple iterations on a site plan and being able to do it really quickly. Was able to make an amazing project come true. I'll go over a little bit later. Don't believe it, try it. And then, of course, we'll end with questions. So let's start with a quote. I always love starting with quotes because this is a good way of getting our mind in the right direction. This one's get closer than ever to your customers. So close, you tell them what they need well before they realize it themselves. As designers, this is the way we got to think. A lot of times, especially in site, clients don't always know all the zoning. They don't know way things for stormwater or whatever it may be. They don't know everything that goes into creating a project. And these can be internal and external clients. As we know, sometimes if I'm doing something, if I'm a DOT and I have somebody needing the rest area or material lay down or maintenance, they don't understand what it means to do site because they're not thinking about all the different bits and pieces. And maybe they do. You know, we don't always know this. So we take the assumption a lot of times that our clients don't. That's why they're hiring us to do our project. So what we got to be able to do is be able to present to them things in a way they are not used to thinking about it. For example, I had a business for a number of years, and a lot of times I'd meet with a client, a lot of times at lunch, and they'd already have something drawn out on a sketch, and that's what we call it a napkin sketch, and they already give me an idea. Hey, I'm looking at doing this residential community, and this is what I think. And then God bless them for trying. That's what we want our clients to do, to give us some direction into what do they need. But at the end of the day, it's our job to come up and do it. And the only reason I like this quote is because before they realize it themselves, because a lot of times they're not looking at every option because that's, again, not what they do. That's what we do. To be able to look at that, we need to be able to have a tool set and a workflow that allows me to do things quick enough. For example, if I'm doing a residential community like I talked about, and it's 400 or 500 lots, traditionally using CAD software, if I met with a client at lunch, I'm probably going to meet with them 2 or 3 weeks later. Maybe a week, again, depending on the complexity of the project, and get done fast to run through multiple iterations and give them an idea of what's the best thing to do. Not hours, not a day. And that's what you're going to learn in this session. We're going to show you how to come back and bring in your experience to bring that time frame back to a shorter amount, an hour, 2 hours a day, again, depending on the type of project. So let's go in first of all and get a good understanding of what we mean by reality model and reality modeling. They are two different things. Really, one is an item, one is an action. Now, reality model, a lot of different ways to start making them. A really good one that Bentley has is with context capture. That will go in and do things such as drone imagery. It could be something as simple as your cell phone. Combination, it could be aerial imagery. It can come from a lot of different data sources where its ultimate goal, quickly acquire data, go over like you see on the right-hand side, and we'll create a mesh from this. Not always a point cloud. A point cloud is okay, but it gets very cumbersome. I have to go in and then create a mesh and a surface from it. We want to be able to go in, quickly grab this information, and start working. And that's what you're going to be able to do as I show you going through this process. But the big thing is we need a model to work from. We can do the modeling all we want. And a lot of tools over the last couple of years have had the idea of building modeling as part of their workflow, but it takes so long to set up this initial data that a lot of us just haven't adopted it. It's too time consuming. I mean, we got to make money. We got to stay in business. We want to deliver our clients the best, but we can't go out of business doing it. And clients a lot of times don't want to pay for that level of information. So once we get a model made, then we want to go into the actual function of reality modeling. We want to actually do something with it. So if I took a site, and this is where we're going to go from Bentley's context capture, we're going to go into SITEOPS. Now, this is a tool I've been directly involved with for about 8 years now, and it's a fantastic tool. Because when I had a company, like I said, I did tons of designs. I did everything from McDonald's on the corner to 26 to 30,000 lot residential community, basically a town. I would have loved to have had this tool because a lot of times I had in my mind what I wanted to see, and I would spend weeks getting there. Inside SITEOPS, I'm going to go through, for example, we see a little refinery. The three options, those were just about an hour, hour and a half of looking at it. And for each one of them, because I have a model, and now a model is not just a collection of lines and surfaces. It's intelligence. It understands parking lot slopes, roadway slopes, tie-in, pond requirements, stormwater. I can put in this information, and I can have it start helping me to look at potential problems, designs. Now, the one thing, I always like to bring this out, in modeling, is not replacing. It does not do work. Let me phrase this. It does work for you, but it doesn't tell you where to put things, how the relationships are. What it's really going to do is you leverage being an engineer, an architect, a landscape architect, a planner, a designer, is leveraging your experience to come up with the best answer for the client more than your best ability to use CAD. So when you go through SITEOPS, we're going to do the reality modeling. We are physically doing modeling. We are changing a 3D structure. So for example, if we look at number one, I've got a site plan that took maybe about 10, 15 minutes to design because I knew what I wanted. I just needed now a tool to help me do it faster. I click a button and it takes all the requirements that I have for that site and it starts grading it. And it's looking for the best cost of construction because again, that's what our clients want. I want to be able to grade it. Red is cut, blue is fill, yellow is little to no elevation change. Get a nice little representation of grading. And you can see that for each one. Now this is really good for me. But the other part of modeling is because again, we have data, we have information, we can also use that to create budgets on the fly. So if I change something, I can see the difference between different projects. So for example, if you look in the lower right, you got about 2.72 million, 2.8, but that one option number two, 2.4 million. They can get everything they want, save a couple hundred thousand dollars. Now think about going to a client with that. Maybe the client said, I want number one. But because of my speed and my ability to think out of the box and come up with alternatives as an engineer, I would go back with the client and say, great, here's number one. Here's some other options that maybe we want to look at. And we know a lot of our clients, if you go up to a project that just knocked off $300,000, they're going to be pretty good consideration into what that option number two delivers. Now, again, they may not have told us everything. We may not know that they had expansion plans for that area later. Those are kind of things we don't know. So we wouldn't have wanted to spend days inside of a CAD program coming up with that option to realize we couldn't do it. But what if, again, if I could spend minutes or an hour, it's worth going because that client, if he was happy or she with number two, that's a client that's going to be with me for a long time. I'm going to get that repeat business. That's a client's probably going to tell his friends about, hey, and we see this in this workflow. Hey, I just had this fantastic job done. The engineer saved me hundreds of thousands of dollars and you need to use them. Again, word of mouth is a great way to do that, but you got to deliver it if you want word of mouth. So then the last thing, this is sometimes probably the hardest thing that I ever have to do, is that is getting people, stakeholders, to understand what my design intent. Let's go back one slide, or actually, sorry, two. Those drawings across the top, if you're an engineer, architect, probably a contractor, different things like that, you probably have a pretty good idea of what you're looking at. If I'm going into a zoning board, I'm going into some clients, I'm going into a bank to try to get funding for the project, or the client is for a project, they may not understand what it is we're trying to design and do. But you bring in something like this imagery I'm showing right here. That is what makes the difference. But the whole key of this, what I'm talking about today, is reality modeling. I cannot get from that input of data to this without creating a model, and this is what's called LumenRT. And I'm going to show you this whole workflow and how fast it can go in just a few moments. But this is what we want to give out to stakeholders in a project. Again, imagine I was on a number of planning boards in the region of North Carolina where I am, and I'll think of the one for the town I'm in. I was the only engineer. on the board. There were eight others. There was nine total. A couple bankers, a member of bank president, a house, a stay-at-home mom, a couple retired people, things like this. But none of them were an engineer and architect. And every time somebody came to show us something they wanted to do in our town that didn't have a visualization, I ended up spending my time trying to explain to the other board members what was the intent of the design. So imagine with this, you don't have to. I can create videos, I can create imagery, I can create what's called a life cube where you could just give it to them and say, hey, look at it the way you want to. So we're talking about this reality modeling, but before we go into showing it, we got to talk about a workflow because this is one thing I always show and I always make people understand that if we cannot fit it into our workflow, it's going to be hard to adopt it. So we got to figure out, do I need to tweak my workflow a little bit? Do I need to come up with something different, or does it fit into it just fine? We've tried to make all these tools fit into a workflow that fits naturally into what you do today, sort of the one we see across the screen. This is a probably for site, most people call a standard workflow. We got to have a location, we got to have a project. We want to get data, got to create a plan, a grading, stormwater, budget. Then we want to get stakeholder buy-in. Of course, we're going to go back and forth a couple of times once we get it. Then we get into plan production. And the tools you have for that, your MicroStation-based tools, or even if you're using some Autodesk or Carlson or other softwares, they're all good at doing plan production. And that's the problem. They were all built to do plan production. Conceptually, which is where the project either is most likely going to fail or not, they're sort of slow. We need something that's going to speed this up. And the beauty of reality modeling is we're going to speed this up a lot so that when we do get to that plan production, we know what we want. All we're going to do is use the tools that they are fantastic at doing, which is creating documentation. They're awesome at that. We're going to get to that stage a lot faster. We'll get there, and like I said, it could be as simple as hours to a day or a week instead of a longer period of time. So where does each of these steps of reality modeling fit in the workflow? Well, of course, first there's data acquisition for this site. Now, again, you don't have to use context capture. Everybody's got their own way of doing it. This is just one easy way that I'm hearing a lot of people starting to do it. Somebody will go out and do the site visit. They take a drone with them. They fly it over to site, depending on the site, in a few minutes, 30 minutes, or an hour. They come back and they create a model. Simple as that. It's not a very hard thing to do. And then you want to go into SITEOPS. This is where you want to do your site planning, grading, stormwater, creating those budgets, getting those multiple iterations to show a client to get an idea of what do we want to give to the stakeholders. And that's where we go to Luminar T. And I want to show you how quickly, just again, click of a button, I go from one to the other. A lot of this is a lot of one talk, just click a button, go from one to another. We're trying to make it where you spend more time designing and less time on software. That's the way it makes it better results in the long run because you can look at more options. So what's the one big thing that you get out of this that, again, the other workflows don't deliver? And this is the part that drives us all crazy in this industry, and it's revisions. And I talk about this a lot because when I had a company, if I could have got paid for my revisions most of the time extra, I'd probably be retired now. Because for every project I did, I probably did it 20 or 30 times, especially in that conceptual phase. If I got paid, I only got paid for one. And they usually only got paid for the one that we actually went through full construction documents. And I love telling a story. It's one that how I got started years ago was a developer here in the Charlotte, North Carolina region come to me one day and said, if I give you the money to start a company, will you make me your number one client? And I was like, of course. My eyes popped open. I said, yes, I'll do that. And it was a year or two later that we were at a big developer show, and somebody asked him, said, why did you give him the money? Why didn't you just want him to work for you? Things like this. And he goes, I want them impartial to me. I don't want them to give me the right answer. He goes, the best thing these guys do for me is not tell me yes. Is tell me no. The biggest thing you can do for a client is not always help them make yes, because if they don't get a good enough answer and they say yes to a project and it turns out being a bad project, whether you did a good job or not, they're going to look at all, the whole team as a negative. So a lot of times, in that feasibility stage, we hear from people using this type of workflow that the clients love it because it's a thumbs up or thumbs down really quick. Because if I'm trying to find a place to put a new facility and it don't work, I don't want to waste 2 months figuring out it don't work. I want to know it don't work now, and I want to go move somewhere else to try to figure out where to put this facility. So this workflow, again, is not just about speed of our design, it's about speed of decision making. Makes everybody happy. So let's jump in. Let's take a look at this real quick, and we're gonna, again, we can ask questions at the end, and please do ask questions when we get to that point. We'll do that. And every so often, Gerald Burke is on here with me as well. He's another PE that's in the SITEOPS group. So if you get enough questions, he'll break in and start asking them from me. So I'm just going to start up SITEOPS. SITEOPS is a sort of web-based type software. The little orange bar you saw, that was actually me just loading and installing the latest version, which is really cool because I don't have to have gigs of information to start a project. Oh, if I actually put in my username correctly, that might would help. Sorry about that. There we go. And now once I go in, you can see it's a very simple interface. So I'm in SITEOPS. I didn't go into context capture directly. We're going to take the assumption that's already been done. Okay, I'm going to go in and we're going to start using that information to create a project. So I want to go to base map, just pull in an empty boundary, and I'm going to go to import. Now, SITEOPS allows you to go out and get information from a lot of different places. I can geolocate it, and then I can bring it in from USGS. I can bring for international SRTM as a topography that's pretty much except on the poles around the world. We can bring imagery in from Esri. You can bring your own in. You can bring in your own information. A lot of different ways to get started. But today, I'm going to bring in 3MX. Now, 3MX is the file that comes out of context capture. And it can be web-based. So I'm going to give you an idea of what I mean by context capture. Again, you created a flight. You've created imagery. They will then go in and stitch it together. So here's an example. This is Helsinki. If you go in, this was done by Ariel. I go in and look. And what it does, it also levels the information. So as I zoom in, the information will get better. So you can do it on a city level. You can imagine coming in and doing a site plan, maybe in the little park area. We're going to redo the park, and then they can actually show it in context around the rest of the community. We could come in and do it by, there we go, on a non, this is locally, this file itself is locally on my machine. This is one that was done with a combination of some pictures and some droning. And if I go in, you can see it's very detailed, even to the point that it caught the power lines, stop sign, all kind of different things. You can see that, again, a lot of information, and it's going to come down to how detailed do you bring it in as to how good it is, okay? You can't just go in and take one big picture and think it's going to work. It's like anything. The more information you get, like a geotech report. If I get 2 points on a project, I might miss something. If I get 100, odds are I'm not going to miss something. So the more information you put in, the better. So we can do that. Now I want to bring this type of information into SITEOPS. So I'm going to tell it wherever that file is located, whether it's on the web or on my local machine, I'm going to say okay. SITEOPS is going to look at that. And this is an area called Coatesville, Pennsylvania. It's one that Bentley went out and did the flew a plane and did some photography to supplement it. And we're going to go in and play with a little area. Y'all may have seen me use this before. It's a nice little simple site, but there are problems on this site. So let's go in and identify a boundary. Because if we want to come in and do something, again, one thing we're also running into a lot in the industry right now is prime real estate, especially in the more populated areas, it's just not there. So we're going in and we're tearing down and remodeling, or we're just completely tearing down and rebuilding on existing pieces of property. So I may want to come into this old factory district and rebuild it. I want to put in a school or some office buildings that would not be conducive to use these old steel mill area. I want to do something different. But what I need to do, I need to grab information. Right now, all I have is an aerial imagery. So if I zoom in, you can see my image gets a little bit better. But again, it's still just a 2D image. I want more than that. So I'm going to go up and I'm going to go to the import and I'm going to do what's called Clip 3MX Topo. All I'm going to do is just tell SITEOPS, you know what? Look at that. Spend a minute or two, and I want you to create me a surface from this actual information. So just to speed up time, again, just because we're limited, I've already done this. I'll show you what this looks like. Let's go in, and let's go to our base map. Here we go. Again, just sort of fast forward to 3 or 4 minutes. Let this open up. Here we go. And I'm going to turn on the existing topos. Give it a second to come and populate on me. There we go. So I'm going to turn off the 3MX and the underlay image just so we can see that we have data in there. Now, what I'm going to show you the difference is I'm going to delete one area. And let's go back and let it reset itself. Give it one moment. Okay. Here's what the data looks like before I cleaned it up. Now I'm going to show you in a second what I mean by cleanup. Do you see all the contour lines? What it's representing is when it pulled that data from that surface, what it actually did was it pulled, let's just do the underlay image just to bring it up a little faster. It pulled the buildings as if they are a three-dimensional piece, when they, and they really are, but I don't care to use that as part of my site. I want to know the site itself. So what I did was told SITEOPS, let's go back and turn those contours on. Let's turn off some of that other information. Is I went in and told it to create an area. Now this area, what it does is it cleans up and trims that out. So we're just going to go back. We're going to undo and bring that area in. And let's just have it grade, which is just nothing more than having to reset it. It looks at it, give it just a moment, and it's going to interpolate between those points. Again, is this 100% accurate? No. But it's also from flown data. The only way you're going to get pretty close to almost 100%, you got to go out and do a field survey. None of this replaces a field survey, not at this point. But this is a whole lot faster. And imagine somebody gives me information. Maybe this was just from a USGS and it had a mound of dirt in there that you realize is now gone because the client sold the dirt. I need to go in and take that away. So now I've got a starting point. And this is where our expertise as designers come into play a lot more. Question becomes, what are we going to do with this project? So we can come in. Let's just take this underlay down just a little bit, and we're going to play for a few seconds. All right, so we know we have a driveway we're going to have to deal with. So we got to get in and out of the project. So I'm going to come in. Maybe we're going to tie into this existing roadway. Actually, let's go ahead and just do this for a second. I want to show you all some power. And for the ones who haven't seen SITEOPS, this is a tool that we built, started building about 8 years ago on the idea of quickly creating concept plans to make decisions. So if I went into my normal CAD program and I drew a parking lot, or basically put on a layer and drew a polyline, this would be on a layer called parking. That's about all I've got, right? It is not a parking lot. Inside SITEOPS, it is, though. That's the difference. Look on the right. It understands what I'm drawing and what they are. But again, the green box is not going to excite anybody. It's not going to make a client happy. The big question, because I've seen other tools out there that people are trying to use for concept, and then draw a nice gray box, and they can say, hey, this is parking. A gray representation of parking is not the answer. Client needs to know exactly how many parking spaces they can have so they know how much leasable square foot they can have. We got to draw that out. Now, again, in most CAD programs, drawing parking takes time. In SITEOPS, there's a button in the upper right-hand corner. Let's click on it. Boom, I'm done. Before I can hardly say push the button, I'm done. And that's the whole key. Because the only way we're going to start applying experience in a timely manner is I have to be able to come in and start doing things quickly. I have to be able to come and do a driveway. Let's just take it out. I'll move it here in a minute just to match up. But it may be a drive coming out the backside. Maybe we need two entrance points. And do things very quickly. I can come in and do we want one building or two? Let's do a building, I don't know, maybe 150 by 300. Question is, where do we put the building? And this is the whole thing. How do we come in and do different things? This is what the client is expecting us to do. You know, it's funny, over the years of working with SITEOPS, I'm surprised sometimes I hear clients say, when we show them this to developers, they'll say, oh, my engineer uses that. And I'll go look and I'm like, no, they don't. He goes, well, they do it. And I said, what you don't realize is they're doing tons of work in the background for you. But are they all doing the best work for you? And, you know, little things. Again, I'm not going to go through everything, but we can do things like change parking to be a certain direction. I like to do this one. Go over to the right. I can change it to be Walmart parking. I always like to call it that because if you've ever designed one, it can drive you crazy with all the ways they want, the way they want things changed. But the ultimate goal is not just to do a layout. It's to do a layout and grading. Again, remember, we're working in a real model. This, we keep it 2D just to keep it nice and simple for you. But when I press the grading button, this is going to be our first glimpse into actually being in a three-dimensional form. Because this is going to pop up a grading plan that I can now go in and I can see cut and fill. And I probably have a little constraint over here, and I'm going to show you this is a really neat thing. It looks like it's going to fail, which is exactly what we want. So when I'm showing this, so we can come in and see it's very extreme grading. Look at this. The software will even tell me when I have a problem. I don't know if your CAD tools are going to tell you that. Here's a great example. From where the tie-in for the existing road is, I've told my road, my drive at a maximum slope, it's missing getting down to this point by about 14 to 15 feet, which means that driveway is not going to work. Or we're going to have to spend a lot of money moving dirt for no reason. But right now, because that grading error in the upper corner is telling me it's no good, it's no good. So as you go through, you can start seeing that you can start doing multiple iterations of a project really simple. So let's go, say again, we're going to fast forward about 10 minutes because I want to put multiple buildings and roadways and parking lots in. I'm creating something again. We'll just do a little community college on this. So this one's coming in, and I'm going to address what these little white boxes are in just one second. But for now, let's come in and we're going to look at this, turn off some of these layers. Let me just come in and I'm going to turn off. Let's just do another quick layer, set that, turn that off so you can see some more. And I'm going to turn off the underlay image and the contours. So here's a design that's been drawn. You can see it's just basically a building. Now, buildings, I do get a question a lot of times where do buildings come from? And that's going to be up to how the project's being done. If an architect or you know of a building you already want, bring that footprint in. If you don't know and you're trying to help the client decide, you know, what's my maximum lease square footage, then we're going to change the footprints. Similar to the way I drew the other one, you're going to change it and move it. Again, do the iterations similar to just to how you do inside of your normal CAD software. The only difference is you're going to do them a lot faster. So when you make a change, or heaven forbid the client, after you've been working on it for a month, wants to change, you can come back in and change that. Everything in here, again, is editable. So if the client says, I don't need that much parking, let's pull that parking back in a ways and let's change it to look something like, I don't know, we'll just play around real quick. We'll just move it. Let's move that driveway up some so it connects correctly. And let's hit a grading button. So every time I can start making changes, add it in, take it away. That's what it's mainly about, trying to get to that perfect point. As you can now see, I come in about 1.1 million in improvements. I can turn off my boundary because I'm grading in my detention pond. We got some fill. And here's another thing. SITEOPS is going to try to balance the site if that is the most economical. If, for example, if you've got a site plan that requires export because of the way you've got constraints on it, it's still going to export. It's not going to balance a site that's not balanceable. But it can help. You can do this where I can start varying. You know, client goes, I don't want walls. Then you say, you know what? You need walls or just don't work. You can run through a lot of these iterations. Now, once you have this, think about it. We went from a context capture model. We've now went into a site where we're going to do the modeling except we now need to figure out how are we going to represent this to the client. Now, we're going to do this by using LumenRT. Now, the one thing a lot of people have told us in the past that they didn't like about using any 3D tool was the constant revisions. So if I went in and took some of the 3D Maxes of the world and some of the Adobes, if a client changed that parking just like I did there, I would have to export the model back out, make a lot of changes, spend tons of time making the revision. So they said we only a lot of times do the very last model. Well, the problem is model number 2 out of 10 may be the one that's right answer, but nobody really understood what they were looking at. With this concept, we're going to do a 3D visualization for every single one of them. So what you can do, I'm going to turn that layer on we saw in the very beginning. Excuse me. If we go in, inside SITEOPS, you can actually add things. I can add cars, trees, and we have them populated for you. And if you go under your blocks, you'll see blocks in here. Let's see, I just got them hidden under my user. They'll be under system for the regular user. You can do things like add cars. There's tons of cars and plants. I have a few just in this environment for me. Once you go in and add this, you can see if I zoom in real close, you can see the islands. They have trees on them, the spaces, they have cars, and I can randomize how that happens. So if I came in and I moved that parking lot, let's move it back to where it was at. Let's just do that. Start the solver up. I don't have to do anything. My cars are already there. My trees are there. They moved with the islands. Everything did exactly what I wanted it to do. So when I'm doing those multiple iterations, I don't have to worry about the 3D because to do the 3D is pretty simple. Let's hit that grading button again because I did make a change. Imagine that. I just moved and added 30 or 40 parking spaces. I'm not going to have to do a lot of complex work to do grading. I just let it grade up for a few minutes, give me or a few seconds, give me an idea. And then we're going to hit export. Now, the SITEOPS will go out to a lot of different tools. If you don't want the 3D, this is where you can go out to your standard CAD package. We work with all of them. You can go straight to Google Earth and say, hey, here's what it looks like in Google Earth, and send out the KMZ file. But a lot of our users are really starting to say, let's go to LumenRT. You can pick which version you want to go to. What do I want to bring? And about 4 or 5 minutes later, again, depending, this one takes about 3 minutes. McDonald's may take 30 seconds. A residential may take 4 or 5 minutes. Again, the bigger the site, the more the data, the longer it takes to transfer. What you're going to get is a project that an export that looks like this. All this came from SITEOPS directly over. Everything from, because again, I even put in the little entrance sign because we had to grade that in. All the trees. You can see the model. You can see the older warehouses around the outside. Everything came from within SITEOPS, straight over. I could go in and, nice little visuals. And trying, let's say we're doing a community college with the greenhouse and we're trying to go in and do things like that. You can see this is going to help sell to the community a lot better what's happening with this project than a 2D. Even if I had a 2D color drawing, it's not going to be as good as this. So imagine being able to deliver something like that. And from there, being able to make movies. And again, the live cube, which is really cool, it looks just like this, except they take the toolbar off from the side and it goes away. Now, again, how easy is this tool to use? This is about as easy as SITEOPS. If I want to come in and add some more stuff now, I can. I can come in and just start manually bringing pieces in. I can just quickly drop in another plant, a car, a person. I can add where it moves. Again, a lot of different things. I can even come in and add lighting. So if I wanted to go to nighttime, I could go and change the environment to make it different. So if I could come in and say, let's go to nighttime. What time of the day? And it knows based on the, because we geolocated this, where it's at, how are those reactions going to be? So if I go in, let's just look at a couple cars because I don't have their lights turned off. Let's zoom around to the front where they would actually have lights. We can come in and let it start working and it'll start coming in and doing everything for us. We can also go in and do things like affect wind, cloud movement. Again, it's all that little bit of realism that we're adding to it that over time makes everything look a little bit better. Makes the, again, here we go. We're in a windier part of the US. Let's go over here to the bottom right. I'm going to change the resolution, change the quality up just a little bit to make it a little higher. We'll zoom in and I'll just let it set for a few seconds because I know because of the Adobes and things like that, it can take just a few moments for these models to show through as something happening. So this is the workflow we're talking about, is how do I get from a location to this? And again, how does it benefit? It doesn't benefit me, the engineer or architect, or again, anybody doing this type of work. It benefits the client. Anytime we can benefit the client, we're going to go up and do a better project. So again, let's do another Steve Jobs quote. Like I said, I love Steve Jobs. He says, you can't just ask customers what they want and then try to give it to them. By that time you get it built, they'll want something new. Again, I love this one because this is one I should put on my wall here because when I had a company, just like all of you out there, I'd almost meet with a client. By the time I got back to the office, they're already calling me with suggestions. And the ones that really got me was when they waited a week or two to see me. And they go, oh yeah, after the meeting, I thought about this or that. And the next thing you know, I'm doing another revisions to take on something they just thought of or should have told me already. This workflow helps solve that problem. You're going to quickly be able to go out and again, run those different iterations, those different models. So let's look at a case study of this. This was a workflow by looking at multiple iterations done by Manhart Consulting. Fred over there is actually a fantastic engineer and uses this type of workflow to help set Manhart apart from other engineering firms. This was Chobani. They had a task. When I first heard of this, I absolutely loved the idea and that SITEOPS was able to help them. The idea of being able to build, to design, build, and open a large factory of any kind. I don't care if they're building shoes or shoestrings or yogurt. That's a feat. This is almost a 1 million square foot facility. It was $450 million. They had 1 year to design it and build it. And SITEOPS was a huge help with this because they ran through, got the team together, and ran through these iterations. Didn't spend weeks trying to come up with site plans. It's more like days because they can run through this back and forth. We need to put customer park or employee parking here and distribution there and material area here and manufacturing versus office. They can move all these different components around so that everybody could get to the point where they needed to be. So again, here's what it even looked like inside SITEOPS. They did a conceptual grading, the building, you see detention pond. But I love this. Think about this. I don't know how many in here have done this type of project. This is a massive undertaking. The point that they started in November and was doing groundbreaking around 6 weeks later is almost unthinkable. Most of us are just trying to get our first or second revisions of the site plan done at that point. More or less the site plan done, designed, again, went through multiple iterations, and then they opened it a year later. That is phenomenal work. That's the kind of thing that if they'd went through a normal CAD program, they would probably never got there that fast because they'd went through spend a lot of time just drawing, not thinking of what to do, but drawing it. This way, they were basically able to leverage themselves, spend more time engineering and less time drafting, which again meant they were able to deliver the client a better product. All right, so I'm going to give y'all a little special treat. Y'all are going to be the this is the first tech talk that I've been able to show this. So I call it "Don't Believe It, Try It." When I'm moving things around, making things look easy, some people are like, "Wow, that looks a little too easy." Now I am going to be honest. I'm part of the SITEOPS, so the other tools, Context Capture and LumenRT, have a free trial. But we're giving a free trial, but don't expect to go in and try to be an expert right off. No software is that way. Doesn't matter if it's Microsoft Word or us. Take a few minutes. There's help videos. There's learning material. We're going to be able to take care of you. Now, there's two ways of getting this free trial, and I'm going to go in back into tool in just a second and show it to you. But for the Bentley users, you can go into your software fulfillment, go under brand, there's SITEOPS, and grab the first one called SITEOPS. When you open it up, there'll be one file to download. Download that. It'll load a little installer against a small little file. When you are asked to do the sign in, which I'll go back in, like I said, I'll show this in a second. And again, this from the sign in on, this is the same for everyone. You hit free trial, you'll give your information, and then you can use the free trial. For anybody who does not have the ability to go into the Bentley software fulfillment area, just email david@siteops.com and just say, "I want a free trial." And I will send you the install file, which is about a meg. Really, really cool part about SITEOPS, it's extremely small software. Which will get you started on your free trial. So let's go back in. And I just want to go back down to the bottom and I'm going to show you what I mean by free trial. So I'm just starting SITEOPS. We're going to go in. And right here, there's a little free trial. When you click free trial, you can see I've already set back up today. You're going to get 7 days to use it. All I did is put in a name, a company, an email, and phone number is optional. And I want to say use trial. And here it's just giving you a little bit more information. Say okay. You have to agree to an agreement. At this point, I'm into a free trial. Now, there's a couple of things I can do to get started. Now, I do want to make sure everybody understands one thing. You cannot save by hitting just the save button. You'll have to save things locally, and I'll show that real quick. So you can go under administer. We have a couple projects already preset, and over this week, we're actually throwing more up there, so you'll be able to see that. If you want to start using SITEOPS, the easiest way to do it is go straight to SITEOPS free trial, and there's a demo account in there. And it's going to open up, and now you're working in an account. I can go in, I can use my geolocate, I can import things. I go back if I hit base map, make sure that's the important part. If I get the blue box, I can even then go in and bring my 3MX files in. And just letting you know, this one that here have Coatesville that I just showed you, that is the default. So you can go ahead and start playing with that one if you want to as well, just in case you don't have one. And once you create items, the exports will come up for you as well. But there's also in the upper right, real quick, I want to show this. There is a, I'm going to just turn that down so you don't have to listen to it. There is a video that helps get you started, get going. You can actually pull this off and dock this on another monitor and watch it. Again, there's other information as well. You can always go to help. If you go to help, there's also, again, video searches and web and again, all kind of different things we can do. You see a little quick start button, which again will throw you into our actual Bentley communities, which anybody can get into and start actually, again, learning a little bit more about the software. So we got a couple different ways to get into SITEOPS. So I want to show that again, want everybody to know that we believe what we built, It's worked for a number of years now. We got thousands of users. It's time for you to maybe add it to your workflow, but go out and try it for yourself. You're going to be amazed at how fast you can do things and how the software is really not that hard to use. We made it, we tried to keep it fairly simple because, again, we're trying to do all those projects in the beginning to keep them simple. We need to go with that. So let's take some questions and see what some of your comments are.
All right, David, got a question here. One person is asking, how long does it take to learn SITEOPS and become a good user?
That's a valid point because I hear that a lot. It's a concern with everyone. SITEOPS is like any other tool. Now, it's not as bad as CAD. I taught Civil 3D and Land Desktop at night when I had a company at the community college here in Charlotte. And it was a college course, there's no doubt. This is not that level training. If you actually elect to have the training class, it's only about 3 days. But it's like any software, you got to use it on a project or two to get the nuances, make sure how it fits in the way you do things. But it is not a difficult software to learn. The biggest thing I tell most people when you're learning SITEOPS, it's a frustration you're going to have that I had. You're going to expect it. You're going to look at it and say, oh, if it only did this one little thing, it'd be absolutely perfect. I'd be done. All I had to do is put labels. It's not built for that. It's built for coming up with conceptual ideas. For example, if I'm doing a 1,000-lot subdivision, it's going to come up with 996 or 7. Odds are it's not worth my time in SITEOPS to go find the other three. I'll do that inside of my CAD software. But the client wants to know real quick, I did a 1,000-lot subdivision in an hour or 2 hours. What's my answer? Can I get close to my 1,000? Because if he needs 950 lots to make it profitable and you can only get 900, then there's a big issue. We need to go back and rethink about how we're going to do this project. But if you get 996 out of 1,000 and you get in an hour, they're not worried. They're ready to go forward. You're ready to put this thing into the next phase, which is going down into preliminary plans and submitting for approval. This is what SITEOPS is about. It's how to get to that point where everybody's happy, to get a kickoff, to get to actual doing construction documents.
All right, David, another question here. I'm asking, what is a 3MX file?
Okay, 3MX file. Basically, a 3MX file is a context capture output file. It's a file that you're going to start seeing more generically. Now, again, more than context capture uses this. It's just more of a file that's meant to represent a mesh and a model. That's all it really is. If you point it, go up and into it, it's a lot of point data and interaction between those points. So yeah, it's just a type of file. You'll see other things, but it's the one that context capture uses. So that's why I showed that one. Again, context capture is a great little tool to collect that, to take that collected data and turn it into something.
All right, got another question here. Is there a step-by-step class on SITEOPS?
Oh, most definitely. And for the ladies on here, don't get excited. Our trainer is Tom Cruise, but he's not the movie star. He acts like he is, but he's not. No, I'm just kidding. Tom is a fantastic trainer. We do classes here in Charlotte all the time if you want to come to us. Or, again, you can work with sales. There's different ways he can actually come to you. He does travel a lot. So, again, more than happy. He's a fantastic. He's been in this industry for probably 30-something years. So he knows the ins and outs from the DOTs to, the people building McDonald's. He's a great trainer, and he'll get your people up to speed. He can help identify how to put this into your workflow. So, yes, most definitely there's ways to get trained on SITEOPS.
All right. I got another question here. Can the site information be exported, example, alignment or profiles, back into MicroStation?
Yeah. And what they won't do is they won't come out knowing exactly that they're a roadway alignment. But it will give you the center line, the back and edge and face of curb, other things that you may have associated with it, so you can then quickly pick on it and turn that into an alignment. Because, again, it's the difference of intelligence. If I go, for example, a parking lot inside of SITEOPS, and I take it over to Geopack, Inroads, Open Roads, whatever you may use on a MicroStation. Again, this is in the CAD, Autodesk products as well. They don't carry intelligence. They don't, I can't just move a line in Civil 3D and I'll magically, it draws a new parking lot. So you lose some level of information, but what it will do, it'll be on the layer, and then that way you can use layer translators to turn around and say, hey, here's my SITEOPS drawing, make it look exactly like the way I normally would have drawn it and change the colors and line types and levels or whatever you might be using to make it look the same. So we built it sort of CAD agnostic, so we work with everybody, and you take the information out, and then you just spend a few minutes tweaking and changing it to the way you want it. And then, it's, again, instead of spending a week or 2 weeks to get there, you spend a day or two, and you're at the same point you should have been, again, if you went through the whole CAD process. We're just trying to speed it up for you.
All right, got another question for you here. Can setups design parking structures?
No, that's one I would love to see. At this present moment, SITEOPS does not do parking decks. It can do we let me give you a workaround and then you can go from there. I have a lot of users that will say, I got five levels of a parking deck, and they'll basically draw five parking lots side by side. And then if they move a ramp on one, they have to manually move it on the other. I don't even know of a parking structure tool out there. If anybody does, let me know, because I get asked this a lot. And so people are sort of, I hate use the word workaround, but they use SITEOPS in a little more manual way to do that. So you can definitely design that. It just doesn't have a nice tiered look like a, you know, like an AECO sim or somebody would do, that I could pull out a level, change something, put it in, and it automatically changes all the other levels. I would love to see a tool. I think most of the industry would love to see that tool. It just doesn't exist at this point.
All right, got another question for you here, David. How do you get building materials and site content like you showed in the Luminar T?
Okay. There's a couple, again, there's some that will just go in naturally with SITEOPS. If I did the building, the parking, let's go over to blocks real quick. So here I'm out in the general area. Again, these things are in for you automatically. So if I went into parking, again, something, like I said, I'm going to show you two different ways. If I go to parking, let's just do something real quick. And we'll just do this real fast. I'm going to draw a path around the outer. Let's just go right through it. I'm just going to come in, go under, let's go to cars, and we'll drop an Audi in. I then go over to properties. I pick on this path, and I'm going to tell it that it's a boundary for a block. And I'm actually, instead, I'm going to tell it it's parking, so it knows to see the parking spaces. I'll tell it how many. And then I want to go to edit and assign that block to that area. Okay, so that way, if I change anything, it will change automatically. So this is one way of adding blocks. Now, buildings I could bring in. I tell most people, again, depending on the complexity of the building. That could be SketchUp buildings, EcoSims, Revit. It can be come from a number of different sources. But the more complex the building is, like if I brought in a Revit building that's fully done, that's a lot of extra data that I don't necessarily need inside of SITEOPS. So I may just want to bring in the base plate and move that around. So if we'll just come in and do a building real quick. Just draw a building. I'll just manually draw one. SITEOPS doesn't care what the building looks like. We'll do a quick grade. There we go. Grade, grade, grade. And let's export this to Luminar T. Say okay. Just let it go real quick. And it's going to open the software up for me. And it does this with every software. So if I'm sending this out to my MicroStation, PowerDraft, Open Roads, whatever, it automatically opens it and knows what to do with the data. So this time it's going to come in as Luminar T. And at this point, I can manually add in my building models. This is what I tell most people, because this is the easier way to do it. And this is the point where we can see I have my blue building, and I can come in and let's just zoom in real quick. And this is where I now can start editing as well. I can come in and I could bring in my building file if I had one. I could bring in tons of different files, DAE files, which is a CLOT that almost all those the building softwares work with. They can send you raw files out, 3DS, OBJs, FBX, is tons of different files that are out there. Again, SketchUp models. A lot of our users love those SketchUp models are out there, but I can then come in and do things like, hey, let's turn this to grass. Let this just catch up real quick. I'll zoom in. Whoop, sorry, went a little bit too far. You can see we have grass. I can come in, I can make materials darker because maybe it's brand new asphalt. I want it to look brand new. So I can come in and bring in all kinds of different information at this point to start making the model react. So again, dealing with the buildings, to me, it depends on the complexity. If it's a SketchUp building, a lot of times I'll bring it into SITEOPS. If it's a Revit or EcoSim building, I'll tend to just bring in the base plate and bring it in at this point out here. Just to give you a quick example, this model, just because of the complexity of these buildings were brought in from, this is a SketchUp building, so it was brought in from SketchUp. So if I wanted to, I just imported it and just set it. Actually, I turned the building pads off so you can't see them anymore. But I would just brought it in and just set it on top. Then I used the plants that are inside of an RT to populate the greenhouse.
All right. Got another question for you here, David. Is there a SITEOPS class on the Bentley Learn server?
Yes, there is. Inside the Bentley Learn server, there is a quick start for SITEOPS. So let me jump into that real quick. If I can find my internet, here we go. Bentley, oh, here we go. Personal portal. Again, everybody gets, my people get to it different ways. I go through my personal portal to get there. But yeah, there's definitely training. We do put those kind of things up on there. That's why I picked the right one, but there we go. I don't want a learning path. Find training. Yeah, just run a little slow because I'm running this at the same time. We can come down to the bottom. We can look for SITEOPS. And under here, we have the quick start guide. And then you can even have one thing Gerald does is a fantastic job with some of the SIG meetings. So you can go look at those as well. But we got the quick start to get you up and going. And then you can see SIG meetings, which are supplemental. We have tons of different ways to learn SITEOPS and keep up to speed. We're very interactive with our users. And being web-based, it makes it a lot easier, too. Support is another fantastic thing we do. We love to interact with the users. So if you have an issue, you can send us an email or you can call us. Just get a hold of us, and we will start work because we're helping you with your project. We understand you're time-sensitive. When you're trying to get something done, you don't have a week to wait back for somebody from support. You need to have it done as quick as possible. So we try to get to you as fast as we can to help you get your project in because you may have a delivery tomorrow. Again, we can't have you wait that long. So we're here for you all the way from the training through the support.
All right, David, it looks like you got them all.
Perfect. Again, want to thank everyone. It was my pleasure showing you, and we'll go back up just in case anybody didn't write down the email address. Go to David@SITEOPS.com. If you want a free trial, just hit me up, and I'll send you a quick little link that'll allow you to install the installer. If you're already a Bentley user and you have access to the software fulfillment, go right in there, click it, install it, and have fun. It's a fantastic tool to use. You'll be surprised how quick you pick it up and what creative designs you'll be doing literally within just minutes. So thanks, everyone, and have a great rest of your day.